again for coming here today. And today, my director, also my my boss, Rick, couldn't make it. So I wanted to introduce a little bit about this film before Q&A. So there are a lot of great documentary about Okinawa, focus more on the history with the US base and protest, which I like a lot. But we decided to focus on the nature and focus on like beauty of the local nature with the people who tried to protect for almost 20 years. So I think you know about protester people have a different opinion, but to nature maybe most of people have the same feeling. So we shouldn't destroy like such beautiful nature like this. So we focus on nature. Then a little bit background of how I met Rick, and I actually met Rick in Henoko. So I visited Henoko for my research as a writer and a journalist before, and then I accidentally met Rick. Rick was on the first shooting trip of this film, and then I accidentally met him on the boat, and then like we talked a lot, and I decided to join this film productions back to Tokyo. So we shared a lot of same idea. He's also from Belfast in Northern Ireland, and he grew up in an activist family. So he really wanted to make a film about Henoko. And also my father was one of the canoe protesters also in the film as well. The guy with the hat and introducing about canoe protest, that's my father. So I just visited my father and see like, you know, how he lived. And then like I met teacher, so then I can now join film in New York. I lived in New York for 6 years before I studied in here. Almost 5 years ago, so it's very nice to be back here and show the film to you guys. Thank you very much.
Actually, my screen screen here in my PC is from Chiragami wallpaper. I always use the Okinawa, yeah, the ocean, because it's so beautiful. I like whales and the dolphins. And dugong. Oh my God! I didn't know that. Your first shot, your I don't know how to say it.
The fins.
That too is one.
Yeah, that's so, actually a free diver.
Yeah.
My friend is free diver help us to be like swim like dugong.
But New York has the mermaid parade, so you can come back with that. But I think many of you here, maybe you are Okinawans, but how many people visited Okinawa? Can you just say that? After this film, how many people wanted to visit Okinawa? how many people knew about U.S. military? There's a conflict and a building at the base. How many people knew about this? Okay. So, Ben, I'd like to take questions from you. Do you have any questions?
Yeah. Near the end, there was one long musical song that had lyrics that were not translated. And as I was listening to that, I thought, oh, that sounds so similar to Amazing Grace. Is that an Okinawan song?
Actually she used that Amazing Grace.
with a very local feeling.
Okinawan version.
Yeah. Yeah. Lyrics in Okinawa language, right?
Yes.
Okinawa has a unique history. I think we should Google it if we want to. The dialects are different than the standard Japanese.
very different from
the intonation is a difficult, the words are difficult to
understand. Near the beginning, there was a some writing that was in a very old script, and it reminded me very much. I spent time on archaeology in Kyushu, and it reminded me very much of going into the woods and finding a stone there that had writing on it that looked just like that.
It's your next study.
I can't read
the texture.
How long did it take you to film this?
It's almost spent 2 years. But we are a small advertising company, running company. So we have a business to do every day. But this film production is just aside the business. Mm-hmm. You have to work on, like, after finishing our work, we work on the film. Because we don't have any budget for this film. So just my boss is motivation to make this film. So it was very tough 2 years. So we only 5 employees in our company. So just only 5 of us just work hard to make this happen.
Did you use crowdfunding in any way for budget?
We did, but we covered some of the expense. But we went to Okinawa almost 5 times, and then. Also hire a lot of singer and music and also 3D animation and everything. But it costs a lot of money, so. But yeah, it was tough, but after, you know, finishing this and then showing to many people in not only Japan, to the world, to really I and Rick is very happy now, you know. It was a bit stressful years, but now it's very happy to, you know, to be able to show to many people.
And also, like, I think it could be this segment of a film could be used for lawsuit going on right now here in the state in San Francisco.
It's called like Dugon lawsuits. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I can translate correctly, but it's NGO in Japan and the United States. Mm-hmm. NGO in the United States called like a Center of Biodiversity. That group. Initiate trial to the Ministry of Defense in the United States. They insist that, you know, U.S. government also responsible for protecting this ocean because U.S. military is over there. Mm-hmm. It's not only Japanese government issue. So that trial will be on the table in on the May, if I remember correctly. So in May. So. This film will be showing in the May in San Francisco, Berkeley. Mm-hmm. So that will happen in May. So then trial will start on the May as well. So they nearly almost people in Okinawa almost give up to Japanese government and Japanese people because they tried to make a change like almost more than 20 years. Mm-hmm. Now local people in Okinawa ask me just. Please tell like people in the United States or other country to make something happen because maybe like Japanese government will not do anything. So, but maybe U.S. government. I don't know about the current president, but next president maybe be able to do something. So that's the whole thing.
Yeah. Oh,
it's you know, the first time I met him, he didn't say anything.
He just shooting
me? He was not shooting me, but a little bit later he decided to, you know, use me as a host. Mm-hmm. Maybe because we wanted to make this film for the people who don't know anything about Hinoko. Mm. So not to the protester, not to the expert, more like we wanted to show some introduction of the area. So people like me. Mm-hmm. I actually didn't know anything about, you know, Dearborn or nature of that period. I know a little bit about Colchester, but I didn't know about nature. So maybe that's the actually based on real story. I met Lick and I just didn't know. I just tried to look for try to find out what's in there. So, you think that that's it's real.
Yeah.
It makes it real. So
I think it was like the filmmaking process. A lot of documentaries we've been seeing is it's a little different approach. And I think Zam and your presence, and it's like you are taking to the journey and also showing what's there. The people like, you know, like me couldn't really go to Okinawa that often, and even if I went, it's really, you know, I can see a limited thing. And so it was a really wonderful approach, before, especially for people who don't know anything about Okinawa, in the ocean, and not just the protesters, but the what was surrounding in the island. So I think that gives you, give us idea and imagination of what is Okinawa in a more larger picture.
The manatee in the aquarium, is it in Okinawa?
That's Dugong in Okinawa.
It's in Mie.
It's Dugong.
Mie.
The one in the aquarium, what's in Okinawa?
Toba, is it? Meken. Meken.
That's Toba. It's in Mie prefecture. So it's near Osaka. That's the only aquarium that has a Dugong.
Near Osaka,
yes.
So the dugong come from Okinawa?
I heard that it's from Philippines. There's hundreds of dugong in Philippines, but in Okinawa only 3 or 4 left. Some experts said like less than 10, but only 3 has been confirmed officially. So we don't know accurately. But one baby dugong has completely disappeared. He always come to near the Enoko area, which now starts being landfilled. So of course, like, dugong is sensitive animal, so if he hears some noise, he will not come. So maybe he tried to find somewhere else to feed himself. So now it's really starting, like, all the landfilling constructions, it's now, it's really starting that. It's just, it's maybe more symbolic constructions, because Japanese governments wanted to say to the local people that, okay, construction is already started, so just give up. So that's more symbolic. This real actual construction will start in towards next year. So, but every day people are in Okinawa, our protesters fighting every day, including my father, to stop this space construction. So I wanted to, you know, continue to promote this film in to as many as people as possible in the country.
I'm sorry, I missed almost half of the movie. I apologize, but it might have explained, but did the those protesters in Japan, did they think about going to taking that case to court?
Protesters in Japan?
Right. So because it's a good thing, I was wondering, you know, unless the Japanese government gets, you know, international pressure, they wouldn't do anything. So the exposure is very important. So did they, I'm so used to taking cases to the court, living in this country for so long, but did they,
I'm sure some of the protesters, the experts, doing that, but was not successful for now. I think because all the Japanese court is really get influenced by the Japanese government, as you know, not like United States, more like Supreme Court decisions always affecting governments' directions or opinion. So. Of course, export may be doing that, but it was not successful. So, but dugong lawsuits in May is different because we initiate trial to the than walking something.
Okay, Susan. I found it interesting that one of the professors you interviewed, the young man, said that we are not activists. How does he describe what he's doing every day? And what was the did you get that same vibe from the other protesters you interviewed, including your mom?
Right. Yeah, some people are, I guess, a full-time activist.
Yeah.
But some people are actually normal people. I think most of them are just a normal. He's actually a student, and he came from, I think, Hokkaido. Hokkaido is far from Okinawa. So he used summer vacation to come there to protest. So most of the people are like that. And then, because why he say that? Then because most of the people in mainland, for example, people in Tokyo think that, you know, all protesters is just crazy people, you know? It's just, you know, I would say that it's unusual people. That's the normal Japanese people think about protester. But I think he wanted to say something for that, because we're not activists, you know, not get paid, you know, just come from, you know, decide by himself to come. So maybe he's against that. I'm also against that, you know, people saying that kind of thing, so I'll just, yeah.
Quick question.
When you start filming under the forest, what are the unique or special things that you all of a sudden have to deal with?
Actually, my boss, director, went underwater here. I can't carry your camera actually in underwater, so he did it. So, and I was in more like sea surface,
yeah,
shooting with GoPro. So that's what I did, like shooting behind scene. Mm. But from surface, like I could see like the blue polo that's showing in the beginning of the film. It was like mountain in the ocean. It's like a big mountain in the ocean. That's what I saw. It's the beautiful, it's massive coral. So some experts say that that's the only, you know, Ola Bay is the only place that, you know, we can see blue coral like that. So
wow.
It's the only place in the world, you say. That's what's amazing. Yeah.
Earlier in the film, you kind of walked through a timeline of like some of the negative pressures on the populations of the dugong, but I don't remember anything past like post-World War II. So what are some of the reasons why there are so few, I mean, less than 10, it's like a miracle that there are still, you know, any at that point. So in the past couple of decades, what have been some of the pressures that have kept the population so low?
It's the after World War II, it's people are actually starving, right? There's no food. I heard they captured the dugong. They called the dugong to eat.
Right.
So that's...
But what about like, since, in the past couple decades, like since the 80s, 90s, still for food?
Mm-hmm.
Contribute, like, from the beginning, it's not many dugong left, actually, in Japan. Other countries, there's a lot, like in the Philippines, more like warm area. But in Japan, there's, I don't remember the number, but it's not a lot from the beginning. So, to the World War II, like, people caught for their food and also contribute to the local government. That dugong meat was considered as a really special things to contribute to the king. So they use for that kind of things. So maybe that's one of the reasons. But sorry, I don't know about the accurate number, but maybe the beginning was already low.
The best contribution.
I don't know, I was in Florida,
and
I was there for 2 years. Those ecosystems that are really important to the world, because the mangrove and the
Yes, the scientists insist that point. You know, dugong. It's scientifically dugong is the. It's considered as a barometer of the health of the oceans.
Right.
So if dugong disappear,
right,
that means like ocean is not in good shape.
Mm.
So some experts and scientists talk like that, and also like in Ola Bay, it's not only ocean as you say, like mangrove,
mm,
and there's a two rivers, and also like how do you call it? Because there's a lot of like it's not only ocean, it's all of the combinations like mountain and
mm,
river and mangrove that creates like biodiversity. So that's the NGO that supports us for this film. They really insist that point to the government.
Could I make
a quick
one? Well, I just wanted to respond to that, but it's okay.
What do
I was just going to also say that you have to remember that the argument is up against the U.S. military. They're the ones who devastate whole areas and don't care about the environment. So I don't think that makes an environment.
Who's pushing Japanese government? So.
Yeah. Well.
Yeah. But anyway, thank you so much for coming here.